You may not have heard of neodymium, but you're probably carrying some of it around with you right now. It's in your cell phone, your headphones, and you might be driving several pounds of it around in your car. Neodymium is one of 17 chemically similar elements called rare earth elements, and demand for this metal is on the rise.
Neodymium is responsible for most, if not all, of the growth in rare earth demand at the moment.
Neodymium comes from the ground. It's a rare earth metal, and none of them are actually rare. They're just hard to get out of the ground.
Rare earths are quite distinct among themselves within that family, but one of the characteristics that they do all share are these fantastic magnetic and conductive properties.
For an iPhone to vibrate, for AirPods to play music, for wind turbines to generate power, and for a Toyota Prius or Tesla Model 3's motor to spin, they need magnets. Powerful magnets. If you combine neodymium with iron and boron, you can make a neodymium-iron-boron magnet, which is the most powerful type of permanent magnet ever created. In the case of your cell phone and earbuds, using neodymium magnets means they can be physically tiny, but still strong. For motors, using permanent magnets means having powerful, efficient motors that use fewer electromagnetic components. Magnets might seem trivial and most useful for sticking things on your fridge, but the neodymium iron boron magnet market was actually worth $11.3 billion in 2017.
In a couple decades, we're forecast to have over a million electric vehicles on the road in the US, and that's gonna cause demand of neodymium to surge.
Demand is currently outstripping supply on the order of 2,000 or 3,000 tons per year.
Today, that supply comes from China, which produces more than 80% of the world's neodymium. In 2017 alone, China mined 105,000 metric tons of rare earths, while the US has only produced about 43,000 metric tons combined in the last 20 years. But it wasn't always this way.
The United States used to be the most important single producing country for rare earths from a single mine called the Mountain Pass Mine in Southern California near the border with Nevada. In the 1960s and 70s, this mine was the dominant rare earth mine in the world.
Around the time that was happening, China was investing deeply in its own rare earth metal mining and production and succeeded. So from the late 90s to 2010, China became the dominant player, and they control a majority of the market.
The risks involved in relying so significantly on a single source for such a valuable commodity were illustrated during a trade dispute in 2010.
In 2010, the price per metric ton was right around $50,000. And then in 2011, the price per metric ton jumped up to $250,000.
While the price has since come back down, concerns remain. Earlier this year, rare earths narrowly avoided being included on a new list of U.S. tariffs on Chinese goods.
Originally, in the $200 billion proposed tranche of Chinese tariffs, neodymium and other rare earth metals were on that list. Interestingly, the final list of 6,000 Chinese products that were targeted, neodymium and the rare earth metals were exempted. And I think that's interesting. It shows how important rare earth metals are to the U.S. economy. Shows we're concerned about it, and I think it shows to the Chinese that we're vulnerable there.
More evidence of these elements' importance is that the U.S. is going to start producing rare earths again. The Mountain Pass mine in California was recently bought out of bankruptcy by two U.S. investment firms called MP Materials. The company says it wants to rebuild a rare earth industry in America. And while right now MP Materials still has to ship material to China for further refinement, sources close to the company say that it plans to be fully self-sufficient in the US within 18 months. Historically, though, extracting and processing these materials has not been without consequence.
If you want to open a neodymium mine, you're going to bring up a whole bunch of other elements, sometimes thorium, sometimes uranium. And what this does is it creates, alongside your mining operation, a radioactive waste management problem. It's very difficult to open a mine in a particular place without destroying the landscape and livelihoods that were previously there.
But Klinger is optimistic that as demand rises, better processes will be implemented.
One of the things that is good about the projected increase in demand for neodymium is that we will likely see a diversification of neodymium supply. And my hope is with that, we will also see increased international cooperation around recycling and reclaiming neodymium from spent electronic motors. When we succumb to these doomsday scenarios that, you know, China could quote unquote hold the rest of the world hostage with its rare earth supply, what we're actually doing is we're failing to take responsibility, you know, for our own production needs. And we're also further distracting from the very real potential to clean up the entire supply chain here at home and in collaboration with international partners.